Hey there, welcome to the Total Bitcoin Podcast Show. I'm really, really looking forward to my next talk interview with René Pickard. He's originally from Germany and lives in Norway, works in Norway. And I met him one or two times at some of the Bitcoin conferences. He's, of course, a techie, where I can't really go into, you know, the rabbit hole of technical stuff, and I don't want to go there. But like, break things down, you know, what is he saying? I want to, you know, I'm really interested in his background, why he does what he does, would it be the Lightning Network, working on Bitcoin protocol, whatever he does. And, you know, what is he think about even, you know, let's say even economical facets? What does he think about state, nation state, government, central banks? What are the, you know, the real technical challenges, you know, in a language comprehensible for the average person, user out there? What is Lightning Network? What are the technical obstacles or challenges? What does he think about privacy? What does he think about Bitcoin in general? What's the vision behind Bitcoin from his perspective? What does he think about, you know, freedom? Does Bitcoin, what's the relationship, the connection, Bitcoin versus state versus, you know, individual freedom, sovereignty? So these are the things and thoughts and reflection I want to go through with him, and hope you're going to enjoy this. Please let me know if you have any questions afterwards. We're looking forward to this talk with him. And yeah, talk to you soon. Thanks so much for support and for listening. And without further ado, here's my talk with René Pickard. Welcome to the Total Bitcoin Podcast Show. My name is Kevan Davani. My very special guest is René Pickard. René, thank you so much for your time, coming on my show for the first time. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Excited to be on your show and to talk with you about Bitcoin and maybe some controversial topics.
Exactly. Hopefully not controversial. René, I've been following for some time. And I think, didn't I see you like at one of the Bitcoin conferences, either in Riga or in Berlin, at the Lightning Network conference in Berlin? Is it possible?
I think I was at the Lightning conference, yes.
Maybe briefly, we met each other.
Yeah, maybe. I usually tend to go to Lightning events.
Yeah, what else? Because that's your focus of your work, of your research, right? So I'm going to let you introduce yourself anyway, but this is the, I made just some notes which I found, you know, pretty interesting. You were pretty engaged in the, you know, what, I'm just interested in the background, you know, of your life, of your work, and of your ethos. You were somehow involved with the so-called Pirate Party, which I was a pretty big fan of for some time, because I thought, you know, I had some hopes that they were, you know, they would solve some fundamental issues, some fundamental problems in our society, in our economics or whatever, by, you know, by going to the root of the problem. So maybe we can talk about it a little bit later. And then I wrote down, you know, Bitcoin, Lightning Network, develop an educated, developing open knowledge and demanding open knowledge, data science, data analytics, machine learning, which also would really fascinate me hearing about from you. You're a trained mathematician, plus 15 years of programming and IT experience. And primary research fields is virtual payment channels for the Lightning Network. And you've also sort of submitted Lightning Network improvement proposal drafts. Whether they're trustless or not, you can maybe elaborate on that yourself. And then what I would also want to know, what is splicing? And what do you mean when you talk about slow and expensive blockchain transactions, just for the education of my listeners? And Bitcoin in a hot wallet, difficult to secure properly. And also want to know about, you've got some students. What is, like, nowadays, we can go, you know, through this like point by point, but what I find interesting is that there are more and more, seems to me, more and more students in the IT or programming code field that are more and more receptive and motivated and excited about, you know, working on open source technologies, you know, and amongst other, of course, on Bitcoin. So this is your floor, René. Why don't you tell us a little bit about, you know, yourself, your background, your path to Bitcoin? What's the bigger vision for you? What does Bitcoin mean for you, for society, for our, you know, for our, you know, interconnected society, civilization, and for our future? Thank you so much for coming.
Right. So this is a lot of questions and a lot of introduction. I might, before answering your question directly, have to say that I have to update my website, apparently. So yes, I was proposing Lightning improvement proposals. But that was when I just started to do Lightning, and I thought we didn't have them. But of course, we have the bolts, so we don't need them, because the bolts are our Lightning improvement proposals, actually. But it's a very old blog post that I wrote, and apparently later on I had different forms of communication. So I should update my website, actually, because it's a little bit embarrassing to be reminded of this like cute approach of getting involved in the open source community. And yeah, that might actually answer one of the questions. It's actually, I mean, to some degree, it's open source. You can just do it. And that's why maybe students are doing it, because they see these opportunities and it's a good like field of study and to gain some experiences. But on the other side, it's also a little bit tricky. I mean, everything is open source. That means you can read everything, but there is also a lot to read. And sometimes you don't know quite exactly how to start and from which angle to approach this. So for example, with the Lightning Network, I studied the white paper, because in cryptocurrencies, we tend to like white papers. But I think everybody kind of agrees that the Lightning Network white paper is somewhat outdated. And I mean, compared to what the Lightning Network nowadays is and what the bolts describe, the Lightning Network white paper is not up to date anymore, right? Mm-hmm. But if you go to lightning.network, what you will find is the white paper. And then you read it and you think you start, right? And then you're like, yeah, but we need to work on this. So yeah, it's a little bit tricky, actually. But that didn't answer your question. Your question was what Bitcoin actually means for me and why I'm doing this. I think as a mathematician in general, I like abstract concepts, and money is a very abstract concept. I mean, most people that you meet don't think about money. They just use it. And if you ask them what is money, they take out a bill or a credit card or whatever. It's like, hey, it's what I used to pay, right? And I would say to some degree, this is true. It's a unit of account that you can use for this. I mean, it's certainly one of its functionalities. But then I guess it's a little bit more. And I think Bitcoin is very exciting because you remove this central authority that is issuing the money. And that provides some really nice and interesting properties. And I think this is a step towards a better civilization.
Mm-hmm. So what is the bigger vision for you? I mean, when it comes to Bitcoin, and since you are also, you know, expert or focused on Lightning Network, what would change for, you know, for the average person out there? Why are we doing this?
Yes. So my vision is like, for the average person, my goal would be that actually not so much changes, because the average person kind of doesn't care, right? I mean, at some point in time, me as a German, I was kind of like invited or forced to change my German D-mark to euros, right? So I had to like calculate in new prices, but other than that, not a lot changed. And I would hope that on the longer term, people would just switch to Bitcoin. They have to like do the conversion rate once in a time, and then they basically just use that and they don't care a lot. I mean, this would be the main vision. For people who care, a lot of things change, actually, because you have your own sovereignty over your money, and that's quite nice.
Right. But in order to go into action, in order to have that need, do you think, especially when we're talking about, let's say, Europe, you know, Western developed countries, do you think the parameters, the conditions are already there? that, you know, because most people, if you ask, you know, other podcasters such as Anita Posh or other people over here, the interest or the motivation, the incentives, the open mind is not really there yet. So compared to other countries such as Venezuela, Iran, you know, where the people have the pain points, there's sanctions, embargoes, inflation, hyperinflation, capital control, you know, real problems. So I just want to go, you know, to the core of the question: why, what would monetary wise change for people, or economic wise? I know we're not, you know, this is not about economics, but why are we doing this?
I mean, I cannot speak for the rest of the world. I can speak for myself, right?
Right.
And I would also argue a little bit about the question if, for example, I have a few friends from Iran and they don't care about Bitcoin. They're computer scientists. They're doing a PhD or even postdoc researchers. Some of them might actually have Bitcoin, but I would argue for the wrong reasons, because for them, it's basically, oh, we opened a Coinbase account and we are holding Bitcoin because we hope at some point in time we get more dollars back, right? Because everybody in the world is still very obsessed with the US dollar. Actually, if you think about the Bitcoin community, my feeling is 95%, and it's probably a very unpopular thing to say, are obsessed with the US dollar.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, whenever the perceived value of Bitcoin changes, people are like making memes about price levels in US dollars. I'm like, that doesn't seem to be very Bitcoinish.
Yeah.
Right? Because I don't care about what a Bitcoin is valued in US dollar. I care about the fact that people should value Bitcoin higher. Yes. I would totally agree it's completely undervalued. But I don't care about how much fiat money from the US government I get. I don't like that.
Yeah. You're right. And you're right.
And it's very interesting to observe that especially people in countries where Bitcoin currently would be most needed still tend to not understand it and see why they should actually use it.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that's, I mean, you mentioned it in the beginning, it's a part of an education problem, right? Because, I mean, Bitcoin is mainly used as a speculative asset, and people have this tendency of, its value already has increased so much, so we can get rich. And that's why we're jumping on it.
Do you think that's an incentive, sort of could be seen also as a positive? Because, you know, there's a lot of hardcore even Bitcoiner who say people come in for the money, but then they stay for the money because they start to understand, to comprehend, you know, what does it really mean? What does Bitcoin really do? Because it will fundamentally change, you know, how the markets work, the economics work, you know, taking away the power over the issuance of money from nation states, governments, central banks, and more going to, you know, logical, rational, and ethical, process, interaction.
Yeah, but this is probably where we disagree. I mean, I mentioned this before, we talked a little bit before we started the show. I mean, what you define as ethical here is probably not what I would define as ethical. Mm. So that's a little bit tricky to like go in this direction. I mean, we can talk about this, but I mean, it's not clear how the market will actually change. To me, it's not clear. I mean, maybe I'm not an economic person. Maybe I don't understand those theories, but I would say it's not clear. On the other hand, I mean, of course you have a conversion rate. Like whenever you expose people to some information or to some product, there are some people who will actually like stick with it, right? So when you expose Bitcoin to a lot of people because they get attracted by the idea of getting rich, there is a conversion rate of people who will actually ask more questions and try to understand it a little bit better and then stay for other reasons. I would argue that, I mean, I'm not in Bitcoin for such a long time. I mean, I basically joined the space in 2018. And I was very surprised that many people were talking about crypto winter and this depression. And I mean, I looked up in the past a little bit, and people were extremely excited when Bitcoin was jumping certain valuations in euro, And I think these evaluations were constantly beaten in 2018, but everybody was very depressed. And you could basically, to some degree, feel like a decline in community engagement, people not coming to events. So apparently, most people who are in Bitcoin are actually in Bitcoin for, I would say, greedy reasons.
Okay. You don't think they would...
That's my perception, right?
Okay.
I mean, there are others, of course, right? But I'm just saying what I observe, right? I mean, I don't mm-hmm. want to be offensive to anybody, but like on a macro scale, right? I'm not talking about single people, right? I'm talking about the fact that like participation in events is declining and meetups are shrinking, stuff like this, right? I mean, mm-hmm. it's highly correlated to the evaluation in US dollars or euro, and it's what people talk about most.
Okay. Now I was thinking, you know, referring also to the monetary properties, of course, of Bitcoin. You know, the absolute scarcity. For the first time, sure. we have a form of money that can be saved. You know, that is hard, that is not inflatable. You know, everything going on with negative rate interest policies, inflation, hyperinflation. You know, all this thing. But you know, we don't even have to go into this direction. I just wanted to know, to have your perspective. Like, what is your drive? What is the motivation behind your work? This is what, you know, what
Well, I mean, okay, so I want to answer the first question and then I basically answer the motivation of my drive and work. I think it's very interesting that Bitcoin is sound money and that it's not inflatable. However, we don't know that yet, right? I mean, the protocol defines it that way, but we don't know how powerful few people or institutions within the Bitcoin community might become at some point in time and change the rules,
right? I mean, you think so? Do you think so? Really?
Well, take the comparison to the World Wide Web. The World Wide Web was the most decentralized technology the world has ever seen. And now most people perceive Facebook as the World Wide Web. And Facebook can change the rules. Google can change Google Chrome, right? So, why was Facebook so useful for people? Because it has a news feed. But everybody could have a website and could have an RSS feed and could have a feed reader. All the technology was out there. It was just very inconvenient for people, right? So despite the fact that the World Wide Web is a very decentralized technology, to some degree, the use case for most of the people became heavily centralized. And there are huge corporations having huge power in this space, forcing rules upon others. Right, and I'm just saying it's not clear if Bitcoin will not suffer from the same problems, right? Because if you create something decentralized, permissionless, well, you actually give out permission for people to do exactly what happened on the World Wide Web, become very powerful, right? Mm-hmm. And to some degree, it's already happening in Bitcoin. I mean, there are some players in the Bitcoin space who are ridiculously powerful.
Can you go into detail?
The stakeholders.
Yeah.
I mean, exchanges are ridiculously powerful. Wallets are powerful. Mm-hmm. I mean, then you have developers who are incredibly influential. I mean, And it's not quite clear how consensus is really created in Bitcoin. I mean, of course, by mining and enforcing the consensus rule in software, right? But now we're discussing about BipSchnorr and BipTaproot and these kinds of improvements. And to me as a developer who is actually like to some degree like really following the technical discussions, it's very unclear how actually decisions are being made. I mean, so far it seems good decisions are being made, but to me it's very unclear how this like consensus is emerging, right? And so that it specifically warns me in the sense of like, I don't know how this will be in 5 years, in 10 years or in 20 years. I mean, we don't know.
That's really interesting what you're saying now, because I mean, I see myself as an outsider here, but the process of you know, proposal making, you know, making proposals to the Bitcoin protocol, like what do you call it, the BIPs, how does it really work? Like I mean, there's I guess
requests.
Okay, yeah, but there's like a small community, right? It's a small community of people that, you know, but it's a maturing process. It's not like, you know, you just, you know, submit a proposal and then, oh, you know, you take a look at it, maybe Rene, you know, and then you say, hey, it's a pretty good idea, let's work on that. So it doesn't work like that, right? Doesn't it? Does it? Or how does it work?
I mean, that's the funny thing, right? If you think about it, Bitcoin to some degree involves a lot of trust, right? Because if I come as an outsider and I just create a BIP and make, let's say, a rather radical proposal of changing something, most likely nobody will take me serious, right? Because I'm unknown, it's a radical change, right? People like stability, we've been doing this for, like, we have some experience, right? I mean, of course, if my proposal is outstanding, some people might pick it up and start to defend me, right? I mean, there is this possibility of this happening. I'm not saying this will never happen, but it's just very unlikely, right? Mm-hmm. And I mean, yeah, I mean, technically everybody can come and make a proposal and then the community can discuss this. My feeling is, in reality, you have like this sixth sense of what is currently of ideas floating around in the community, where the community wants to go. So you make a proposal that goes in that direction, right? You have talked to people in offline events, you have seen these people, you build up trust, you build up a relationship. Somebody says, oh yeah, this is really a good coder, he has some reasonable ideas, or she, right? So in that sense, right, it's a social process, like any open source project is and should be, right, as we are human beings. And that is, for example, one of the reasons why I'm also not flowing so well with this like Austrian economics message, because I think there's actually good reasons why we actually build up society, why we build up institutions, why we have those institutions, why those institutions actually roll in the way they roll. With all the like bad things that happen in those institutions, right? I'm not saying they are all great. I'm not saying I'm totally happy about everything. But I think, I mean, initially these institutions were made by society. It's not that some, let's say, higher force was there and just like created our constitution or something.
Isn't that the core problem, the centralization, like that, you know, a small groups of, you know, clusters of entities, then it becomes more and more centralized, you know, I always ask myself, what is democracy, you know, to sort of overlay that's a different topic. Okay, democracy per se, but do you think? I mean, generally, do we agree that centralization and the threat of coercion, aggression, principle, violence by the state through the state or whatever, or even corporate constructs, are one of the few fundamental problems in our society or structures?
I wouldn't go that far. I would like, let me be like, I mean, let me explain myself on that. I would say centralization in general yields the risk of corruption in any situation, right? Whenever you delegate power to somebody, there is this risk of this person abusing the power or at least not meeting your expectations, right? That doesn't necessarily have to be abuse right away, but you know, you have this like conflict then. On the other side, it seems like humans tend to build those centralized systems where they like delegate responsibility and power to people because apparently it serves them well. Because, I mean, I assume most people are smart and they wouldn't do it if it wouldn't benefit them. Right? The question is on what level, right? For example, I mean, I can be a perfect German citizen by never going to vote, by never participating in the political process, and just, well, actually live a pretty secure life and a pretty decent life too, right? I mean, I get school education, I get basic infrastructure. If something goes really bad, I get some social security, right? It's like I can stop caring about anything, right? And maybe you would argue and say you should care more, you should be more self-determined, right? But maybe that was a self-determined conscious decision of saying, you know what, I just like all these benefits. And for that, I don't participate in the process. Right? So maybe that's the, like, from an economical point of view, is the gain that this person like thinks it makes a win-win situation. Right? It could be, right? I'm not here to tell that. I don't know. I didn't ask people.
Very interesting perspective you have.
Very different to yours, I guess.
No, I really want to understand where you're coming from and what is your thought process behind it, because I find it fascinating. Now if you want to elaborate on this a little bit more, go ahead, you know, it's your stage.
I mean, now you have to ask the question. I mean, I could go in so many directions. So I mean, you have to ask a question to elaborate.
Is the ultimate goal of Bitcoin and all these, you know, things that you're working on, Lightning Network, isn't it to sort of give the, you know, the best possible free space and structure and playground for every, you know, self-autonomous, self-responsible, freedom-seeking human being without harming anybody else, you know, without harming anybody else? I don't want to go into philosophical things now, but so that we as individual within the either a community, a municipality, a county, let's just say even yes, a state, or you know, a bigger structure, or even you know, human civilization to interact more freely. Isn't the ambition or ambition? I'm not even. Wouldn't the ultimate goal be more sort of deep, evolution, prosperity, joy? Let's just really break it down. What is the essence of all these things that we're working on? Isn't it to have more freedom? Is it about freedom?
I would say a big argument for Bitcoin actually is freedom. Yes.
Okay.
I would agree with you on that. But again, then I think freedom is a very like nuanced term. Probably I have a very different definition on what freedom is than you have, right? In particular, because I'm at least not a philosopher who has like studied these
me neither.
for a long time, right? So, but I mean, you also brought up the topic of power, of not being harmful, and you made the statement that governments might be harmful or might be violent, right? I mean, these were your terms. The question is, can you like be in a like very free setting and environment, do what you want to do without harming others? I would say your actions always affect others in one or the other way, right? And I would even argue it's impossible to not do something or to do something without being certain that you never harm anyone with it, right? So right, it's a little bit philosophical. But it's difficult, right? So I'm not sure if that's the ultimate goal for Bitcoin or for me in Bitcoin, right? I mean, I personally just think it's good to separate certain concerns, right? So for example, as a pirate, I thought it's good to have a clear separation between state and church. And in the same way, I think it's a good idea to separate state and money.
Perfect.
I just think it's a good idea.
Right? Okay, we agree. Yeah.
Yeah, but that being said, I still think that we need to have a state and we need to have regulation and these kinds of things, because as a society, we want to interact with each other. And I'm very far away from this anarchist point of view of, hey, that everybody have their right to defend themselves. I mean, certainly because a lot of Bitcoin enthusiasts like these ideas, I have been exposed to them, and certainly through Bitcoin in a like, probably more frequently than I would have been otherwise. And I mean, some of these things read really nice. I just think they're unrealistic.
Yeah, fair enough.
That's my personal opinion, right? And one thing that I actually love about the Bitcoin community and about the fact of this like libertarian point of view is libertarians accept that I have a different point of view. Otherwise you wouldn't be libertarian. So that's actually something that I like about it, actually.
Right. Since you're from Germany, and you are in Germany right now, right? So
I'm in Norway.
Oh, Norway right now. Okay, gotcha. Yeah,
Germany wasn't socialistic enough for me. So funny. I had to go to a country that has a wealth tax, which I very much like.
Oh, really? Are they more receptive also? Are they more receptive, more open-minded to Bitcoin? Are they more active? People in Norway compared to Germany?
No, I think in Norway, Bitcoin is not an issue. Mm-hmm. I think Norwegians are very happy with the life they have.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay.
I think Norway has a very high quality of living. It's true. but they have a 1.5% wealth tax annually.
Really? Oh, yeah. That's, didn't know that. Interesting. Don't they also, isn't it Norway the one of the countries that sort of reserves its percentage of its, I don't know how to express this, you know, a percentage of its natural resources for each individual as a pension retirement, something like, isn't, is that, or am I mixing up with
No, it's completely true. So I'm smiling because I'm actually tried to have conversations with Norwegians and ask them if they if there is any people in government actually trying to do this with Bitcoin, because I think Bitcoin should be a reserve currency. That's, for example, one of my opinions about Bitcoin with respect to states. I think states should actually buy Bitcoin as a reserve currency rather than gold. I think that would make so much sense. So yes, what Norway does is they have oil, they sell oil, and basically the winnings they have, they put in a so-called pension fund. Mm-hmm. And this pension fund is 66% stock. And I think in stocks they have roughly half a trillion euros in assets.
Not bad. Okay.
Okay. So, I mean, if you look at the top Dow Jones and S&P 500 and DAX companies, Norway usually has 1 to 5% of equity in those companies.
Wow. Okay.
So given that, the Norwegian, I don't know the exact number, but they roughly, I mean, it's an estimate, right? Given by like how much equity they have in these companies. They roughly have 20 billion euros in dividends per year flowing into
Norway. Amazing. Wow.
And if you divide this by 5 million inhabitants, that's 4,000 euros per year.
That's pretty good.
I mean,
I wish we would have that in Austria or in Germany or wherever, you know.
I mean, that was actually working in a way that was very socialistic. When they discovered the oil, they basically said right away, let's not privatize oil. Mm-hmm. Let's keep it as a state asset. Mm-hmm. And apparently the Norwegians have, like it seems, to have a government that was working very well for its people. And you can see the Norwegian people, they're all happy. And rich.
Yeah. And I would even say, I mean, it goes in beyond socialist, because it's an, I would say, as an attempt, at least, you know, to distribute, or not, you know, it's a natural resources, it belongs to the whole population of Norway, sort of to allocate, or what do you call it, like to it sounds pretty awkward, but like distribute it equally on an, you know, fair basis. Was that the thought behind it? Or
yeah, that's the thought. I mean, the thought is we are one society and we should as a society benefit from it, right. And then of course you could ask this question on a more global scale. It's like, why don't you distribute natural resources on the earth to all human beings, right? But mm-hmm. apparently borders on states still have some impact.
Now that would be interesting if they really maybe they're going to change their mind and allocate at least, you know, a really small percentage, like 1% or 2%, you know, to Bitcoin.
They wouldn't do more. I mean, they don't allocate anything of their mm-hmm. money into more. Like, I mean, they distribute it over multiple asset classes, right? So they would never do more than 1 or 2%. But it would be interesting if they did this. But currently, it seems there's no interest in doing that.
Okay, great. Okay, Rene, so let's go into the direction a little bit. Let's talk a little bit technical stuff. Why, what are the biggest, because I heard, I've been following you a little bit, it's the project you're working on together with Andreas Antonopoulos and your other colleague, is that a project you're working on?
Yeah, so the other colleague is Rose Beef, or Olalu Ojintokun, Lalu, as we call him. And we're trying to create the first book on the Lightning Network, Mastering the Lightning Network. It's going to be published with O'Reilly, which is the same publisher who also published Mastering Bitcoin, right, the famous book of Andreas. And I mean, we think that more people need to understand the Lightning Network. Mm-hmm. If you ask me, I'm a little bit more radical. Well, maybe not. I shouldn't say that. not in comparison to my co-authors, but maybe in comparison to most people in the Bitcoin community. For me, actually, there's not so much difference between the Lightning Network and Bitcoin.
I mean, okay. I
think Lightning Network is just the payment system for Bitcoin. It's how we should use Bitcoin.
Okay.
If we want Bitcoin to be a currency.
Right. Okay, first of all, let me ask you, because I read at that time, I even bought all the books from Andreas Antonopoulos, even Mastering Bitcoin, even though, you know, I'm not even an intermediate advanced reader or technician, you know, techie. So I read the parts, the chapters, which really every layman can understand and really is really super explained in the book, you know. But the other stuff was just, you know, 3/4 of the book, just too techie, you know. It's just, you know, it's like alien language for me. So the Mastering Lightning, which you're gonna publish together, that would be as well, right? More for the techie guy, not for the average user, right? I mean,
so we try to follow some similar principle of making a few chapters for the average layman, of explaining some of the stuff. But by the end of the day, the Lightning Network is a technical protocol, and we need developers to understand it in order to get adoption. Mm-hmm. Because currently, too few developers actually understand it. And the Lightning Network, I mean, it's a way of using Bitcoin. So in order to understand the Lightning Network, you kind of have to understand Bitcoin. So in that sense, the Lightning Network is more complicated than Bitcoin. Right? Yeah. I mean, I don't want to get into a fight here, because some people working on some very sophisticated problems in Bitcoin, which are probably much more complicated than the problems that I am working in Lightning, right? So I don't want to go into this, like, who does the more difficult problems, but to some degree, the Lightning Network is like, as it like is a superset of Bitcoin. Well, you need Bitcoin plus something.
Right, yeah. You said Lightning is a, or Lightning Network is a payment system, or it's supposed to be like
that's how I call it, yes.
Right, and it's one would imagine it's a no-brainer. It should be a no-brainer from looking at it as at the purpose, functions, the features that it should have. Just send, receive, it should be smooth. I'm a big fan of of really smooth user interfaces and user experience. So my question to you is then, what are the technical obstacles, the challenges that we are generally, you guys are working on Lightning Network that could make it really a smooth operation for every average Bitcoin user out there or Satoshi user out there?
So I recently published a paper where I'm talking about rebalancing of channels. And I bring up the example from Christian Decker, where he was trying to make payments and he figured out, I mean, we kind of all knew it, but it was nice that he brought statistics, that 5% of payments take more than 3 minutes to settle. Mm-hmm. Right? And I mean, you now said like, wow, right? But I mean, compared to Bitcoin, in Bitcoin, 100% of payments take more than 10 minutes to settle, right? So, I mean, it's already a huge improvement. But compared to your Visa card, right? If you go or to your EC card or whatever, right? I mean, if you go to a grocery store and you want to pay and you're in line and you have customers behind you,
yeah,
and then you have to wait 3 minutes until the payment settles, that's bad. That's literally bad. And what makes the situation a little bit worse in Lightning is, to some degree, we currently, with the current version of the protocol, have no control over this. Because it's a decentralized network, so we rely on the nodes to actually behave according to the protocol. But if a node is just there to disturb, the payment might take much longer time. Mm-hmm. And currently, we cannot do, in the current version of the protocol, we cannot do anything against this. At least we don't know anything. There are, however, improvements of the protocol proposed that makes the payment process much more reliable. So, for example, we would be able to cancel a payment. Currently, it's impossible to cancel a payment. Once I initiate a payment, it either fails at some point in time or it settles at some point in time. But meanwhile, it's out of my hand. I don't have any control anymore. But with this improvement, we can basically abort the payment if it doesn't settle fast enough. And that, of course, creates a better user experience.
Right.
So that is one thing. And that's what my research is mainly about, actually. It's how do we make payments more reliable?
Mm-hmm.
Because we have this like decentralized distributed network where everybody is trying to help, but you have to account for actors who are not acting in the interest of everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And how can we still make sure that the network is able to fulfill these requests? And it would be actually very easy to do that if we did it in the same way how the internet is working. Right? The technology is out there. We know how to do that. But the internet, as we know, is a privacy disaster. Right? Yeah. Everybody on the internet can basically, like, I mean, you cannot read what I'm doing on the internet, but if you're an internet service provider, you can see everything. Well, not everything, but everything that goes through you, right?
Wow.
But if you're an internet service provider in Germany, almost everything goes through you, right? If you're holding the infrastructure of the lines from German Telekom or something, well, you can, right?
So you'd have to be really an expert to obfuscate or hide your, I mean, besides, you know, using, let's say, VPN, you know, I mean, a lot of people have VPN or other software. Does that really help at the end of the day? I mean, to...
Well, so in Lightning, the thing is, well, I mean, let's talk about Lightning, right? So in Lightning, we encrypt the payments and we encrypt the payment amounts and we use Onion routing. So we have a lot of privacy preserving mechanisms in Lightning. But that is not only a good thing, because also the Lightning nodes have less information, which, I mean, yes, it was the goal, right? But now I can use this privacy actually again if I'm a bad actor. Because, for example, now if I want to spam the Lightning network, nobody knows that I'm spamming the Lightning network because everything is so private. Right? So, you know, it's just like, and these things, I think we are still in the phase of improving these things. And they're very subtle to grasp and to explain to like laymen, right? Because they seem so easy, we can point out to them problems very specifically. But it's a lot of development time, try and error, research to really get these things straight. So I would say we currently have a prototype of the Lightning network out. I mean, it's running on mainnet and it's amazing if you use it. I mean, most people I talk to say, I never want to do on-chain transactions again. I certainly don't want to unless the on-chain transaction is opening a payment channel. There is still a lot of room for improvement. My feeling is that we're going to manage to do that eventually, but it takes time. And that's not surprising either. I mean, building a good technology usually takes several generations. I mean, the internet wasn't built in 1 week.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, sure, the people worked in the 70s and it was published in 72, but until the internet was really being used with all the like protocols around this, the border gateway protocol for routing tables, right? Private networks, I mean, stuff that you need, DNS later. Right, it took a much longer time, right? And when you talk about some people who are very, let's say, anti-Lightning, my feeling is they're trying to sell something.
Mm-hmm.
And okay. They're making very unrealistic promises or making very unrealistic demands. I mean, I understand that some people are like impatient and might follow for that for these reasons, but building technology just takes time. That's a simple reality.
Yeah. No, I'm pretty realistic. I think a lot of, you know, Bitcoiners, especially the hardcore Bitcoiners are ones who are also in the Bitcoin community and fans of advocates of Austrian economics or whatever, they do say, you know, Bitcoin is a savings technology. And I don't, to be honest, I don't see it as a payment vehicle. For years not to come yet. So I see it for now really just as a savings technology. You can do one or more, you know, payment. I've also paid some, you know, a beer on the Lightning Network at some conference, you know, no problem. But like making it open, you know, scaling.
Well, I mean, let's put it this way. Making blockchain transactions for payments is not reasonable. It's just not. No blockchain system in the entire world can do that. Not one single one that I would know of. Right? Like to a scale that would be a requirement for everybody in the world to use it. And everybody who claims that does it, in my opinion, lacks either this, like, fundamentals in computer science or tell you the story on purpose for other reasons. That's at least, I mean, when I talk to computer scientists and introduce them to these problems, and they don't care about this entire discussion, right? I mean, the first thing they note right away is this thing does not scale. If we were to do payments as transactions. Mm-hmm. However, if we do payments off-chain, then we already know it scales, right? But the usability is not like as good as we want to have it. But and I mean, I mentioned the case in the beginning of our conversation that I think countries should think about having Bitcoin as a reserve currency, right? So this is your argument for saving. I'm fully with you. But I think Bitcoin has the chance to be more than saving. And I think the true value proposition in Bitcoin would actually be if people use it as a currency.
Right.
Because I mean, for saving, I can do other stuff. I don't need Bitcoin for saving. For example, in Bitcoin, I don't get any interest. Right. I much rather invest into the stock market because this is where value is actually being created.
True. But if if we think, if you imagine more and more people slowly, but then gradually, and then, maybe even critically adopting Bitcoin, more and more users, more and more people around the world, and with that absolute scarcity of Bitcoin, don't you think the purchasing power, while simultaneously creating maybe even circular economies? I mean, look at Venezuela, Argentina. People are literally already using it because out of necessity. Because their own currency is worth nothing, or it's hyperinflated, or whatever. So out of necessity, out of the pain points, they're already using it in one way or another.
So, but you could do the same thing with the stock of Amazon. The stock of Amazon is as scarce as Bitcoin. It's probably even easier to transfer, right? So it's very secure and well regulated. I mean, with trust to some degree. Right. But I mean, if you get your stock, you can actually have your stock in your safe, right? You don't have to go to a bank. It's just very convenient. Same way how Coinbase is very convenient for many people. So, I mean, in that sense, Bitcoin is not offering in that sense, right? I'm not saying in general, but in that sense, is Bitcoin, I think, is not offering anything additional, right? There's other scarce assets I could use. And then if you bring up these countries like Venezuela and Argentina, I'm not sure if Bitcoin is being used there. I'm really not sure.
Well, I've seen some interviews, I think even, some podcasters did some interviews in, maybe it was in Peter McCormick or whoever, he talked to the people were, they were sort of interacting whether they had a shop, a restaurant. So they were just using, with the Lightning Network,
But it's very easy to be a podcaster from one country to go to Germany, go to room 77 and talk to the owner of room 77 who tells you I'm using Bitcoin for the last 10 years and it's awesome, right?
Yeah.
But then I'm a mathematician. Mm-hmm. I see how many blockchain transactions we have per day. And then I see how many people live in Venezuela. And then I'm asking a question, is it really used? Are we serious about this? I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless the people in Venezuela just don't trade anything because they're so poor, right? That might be the case. But I would argue that still, like for everyday living, they have to trade something. Mm-hmm. So yes, there might be a few people in Venezuela having some Bitcoin. But I would even argue that the people in Venezuela who have Bitcoin are among the richer people in Venezuela. Mm-hmm. Because currently the value of Bitcoin is highly unstable. And a poor person currently cannot afford to actually invest in Bitcoin. They cannot afford to actually invest in anything. And it's a plain fact that over 50% of the world is just poor. Right? And I mean, this is one of the things where the Bitcoin community, I think, is very enthusiastic about how Bitcoin is like making poor people, like getting them out of poverty. I don't see that. Mm-hmm. Right? Just because at a time where Bitcoin was literally worthless, a few people who were basically, let's say, I mean, not for everybody, but who were students and in that sense poor, owned some Bitcoin, and then Bitcoin gained some value and they were out of poverty. It gives them, I would say, this like confirmation bias of, hey, it has worked. It has to work for everybody because obviously not enough people are using it yet. So if people would start using it, like you know, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy, but yeah, I mean, it's not clear. It's really not clear. I mean, I agree with you that Bitcoin is highly undervalued, but apparently the Bitcoin community doesn't think so, because currently there is still enough people selling Bitcoin every day. Because if the Bitcoin community would actually agree on the value of Bitcoin, within a couple of hours, Bitcoin would have that price target, because nobody would sell before. But apparently people evaluate Bitcoin at its current value. Right? So, but it's funny because like whenever you talk to people and you have these podcasts, they're like, yeah, Bitcoin has to be like moon, million, like everybody's waiting for that. But apparently not even the Bitcoiners believe this. Because why are they selling Bitcoin before? And somebody has to sell those Bitcoins because otherwise we would have a different price. Right? Mm. So something is strange here.
Well, there are, I mean, let's say there's a core of hardcore Bitcoiners, you know, like whatever, you know, there's in our Bitcoin community on Twitter, you know, all these people like Hasma Cook or, you know, all these who are, you know, big advocates of automatic dollar cost averaging, you know, on a regular basis, weekly, monthly, whatever, daily, accumulating, and not spending, you know, you just hoard, you save, you whatever, you accumulate, but you don't, you know, and sort of long-term perspective, low time preference instead of high time preference. And because maybe we do understand it a little bit different or have a, you know, bigger vision for Bitcoin, for the future, for the years and decades to come.
Again, I'm not arguing that these people don't exist. I'm not arguing that. Mm-hmm. I'm arguing that not everybody is one of those.
Yeah.
And I'm arguing that the Bitcoin community is more than those, right? Because apparently what we see, like if everybody would behave in that way, we would have a different valuation of Bitcoin.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's just an observable fact. And I mean, we were coming from Venezuela, right? So going back to that, I would argue that in Venezuela, Bitcoin is hardly used in the same way how it's hardly used in Iran. I mean, I talked to people from Iran. I didn't talk to people from Venezuela.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I would say it's a nice marketing story for people who are here in Bitcoin and trying to make a good case out of it. And it's interesting. I mean, it has some potential, right? I mean, I'm not saying it's not being needed in Venezuela. I'm not saying it's not being needed in Iran. Actually, I think especially in Iran, it's needed desperately.
Yeah.
But people to some degree either haven't figured it out or think it's too insecure or they don't understand it. Like there's several reasons why it's not happening. But apparently it's not really being happening because, I mean, just run the numbers.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. Because I had a really fascinating talk with Zia from Iran. Do you know Zia? He's pretty well known. He's also being often quoted by Alex Gladstein, you know, human rights Bitcoiner. And he gave us, I had a really blast with him because he gave sort of a deep insight. I haven't been to Iran. I myself am from Iran, but I haven't been to Iran since 1979 or 1980. So it was really interesting to get an insight view, you know, what is this whole regime, first of all, you know, what does it look like? What are the pain points of suffering of the people? What does the sanctions do to the people? Because it's been going on for so many decades now, you know,
it's really bad.
It's really catastrophic because people are really suffering. It's the people who are suffering. Sanctions means, you know, suffering of the people. So this is what's really sad. And that's what I'm also a big fan of Bitcoin because I think it will just take away, you know, this whole centralized power and give it back to the people, that the power over, you know, your own sovereignty, money sovereignty.
So I sent out that there was a news article by a big German news outlet, and they basically had, I think even with video, an 8-minute story about Bitcoin mining in Iran, right? So, I mean, obviously some people are doing something, right? I'm not saying there is nobody in Iran using it. I'm just saying the average dude in Iran is not, like, it's not the thing that already is liberating Iran, right? I mean, there's also Bitcoin mining in Europe and in other places. But I was sending out a tweet and tagging several NGOs and saying, if you guys are interested in Bitcoin consulting, I'm willing to offer 10 days, which is 2 weeks of consulting free of charge, to kickstart a project in one of these countries where we have a suppressive situation, nobody cares. And I even have friends working in these NGOs, right? So I not only tag NGO like marketing accounts on Twitter, but I actually send those messages to people working. So, I mean, I have one very good friend working in Afghanistan currently, which is of course not Iran, but I mean, she's in that area. Even NGOs, they don't see Bitcoin as a solution.
Because they don't understand it? Are they afraid, or do they just don't comprehend what's the potential behind it?
I think most NGOs are actually, by the end of the day, it's sad to say, funded by the government.
See? So we're back again to the problem.
but with a very different solution, or with a very different conclusion. Because I find it sad, because most people are not willing to fund NGOs. Mm-hmm. What Bitcoiners or hardcore Bitcoiners are telling me is taxation is theft, and I much rather donate to somebody my money where I think it's reasonable, and then I can do this, and we can solve all these poverty problems and so on and so forth. I mean, all those NGOs are doing heavy fundraising and basically only get funds from the government. Mm-hmm. Right? So in that sense, I would actually say this is a very good example of why this mentality of the Bitcoin maximalists is not working. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I made a similar experience. I mean, I asked, for example, when I started writing a book about Lightning, if the community would be willing to fund 1 year of my work. I think I collected something like 1.2 Bitcoin, which is nice. I'm very grateful about this. But 1.2 Bitcoin is not closely to my time worth as a computer scientist.
Right.
It's unbelievable. And I mean, that was something for the Bitcoin community specifically. And it's not that we have like 100 books about the Lightning Network and don't need another one, right? I mean, people were very excited about this. Mm-hmm. I mean, Andreas approached me and said, hey, do we want to collaborate? Like, we can involve O'Reilly, right? So it's a reasonable project. And I already think put out some educational resources which people like are sharing and saying, hey, this is really useful. But it's very hard to fundraise this. It's much easier to actually go to a university and say, hey, I'm going to do 4 years of my time research. Do you give me a contract? At the Norwegian University, they easily give me that money that I can do 4 years of research. That's the state. That's not the people. Mm. Right? So I'm currently funded by public money to do research in Bitcoin.
That's hilarious.
That must be so ridiculous. That's hilarious. What I mean. For a person like you, this must be completely ridiculous, but that's the plain truth.
No, you know why it's very, very strange for me? Maybe I have a different, I don't know, different ethos or maybe I look at it different because I'm not going to, you know, drop names, but we know there's a bunch of, a small group, let's say, of OG, what do you call OG Bitcoiners, like they've been, in the Bitcoin space since, 2010, 2011, whatever. And so they were sitting on, not millions, but maybe even billions worth of Bitcoin. So, I mean, if it was me, I would really start using that money partially, just a small fraction of it, to build structures, to build, education, to help people like you. But maybe I have a different approach to that. So I'm wondering sometimes, people are talking about philanthropic this and that, but then where's the action? Where's the effective, action? Why aren't there more people, in the Bitcoin space who have been here, from the very beginning and have loads of, let's say, really loads of money, who have the potential, the capabilities to, the financial resources to build, network structures and educational structures and development and product development. And I don't know, maybe I'm really wrong what I'm saying, but do you know what I'm getting at? I mean, this surprises me a little bit that there is not more.
I'm saying this. I tried very hard over the last year to attract funds to do education. And I thought it would make so much sense to be funded by the Bitcoin community and not doing this thing of having a sponsor, because I think education should be independent.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. I mean, I might have been able to find a company who would actually like fund me to do education. But then there's this question of like, what is the real interest here, right? So I thought it should be a community thing and the community should have an interest in this. But apparently that didn't work out. And I mean, you could argue that people having a lot of Bitcoin and sitting on that Bitcoin, well, I mean, they didn't give it away. And maybe they understand the true value and understand if they give it away, right? I mean, if it's my wage, I need to pay my bills, so I'm selling that Bitcoin. But I mean, we had the discussion before of we don't have enough people actually holding onto their Bitcoin, right? But yeah, I mean, it's as I mentioned before. I mean, if you look at Bitcoin, I mean, we don't know exactly how Bitcoin is being distributed among folks, right? Because I mean, we don't know who owns which address. Then we don't know how many people have Bitcoins in which custodial solution, right? The impression, however, is that Bitcoin is even more skewly distributed than regular assets are already distributed, right? So this idea of freeing everybody, I don't think it holds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I mean, they have been generous people in Bitcoin, right? I mean, as I said, I mean, collecting actually 1.2 Bitcoin is quite a lot of money. Let's be very crystal clear about this. I mean, there's many musicians who try to do a fundraiser and try to collect, let's say, 15 grand, and they're not able to do that, right? So the Bitcoin community actually is, I would say, more generous than other mm-hmm. communities.
Yeah.
Right? But it's still like in comparison to how government funded stuff works, different order, very different mm-hmm. order of magnitude. So I would argue, going back to the example of the NGOs, why would somebody working in an NGO spend 2 weeks of their time, which is limited anyway, to investigate into a potential Bitcoin project, but then from the donors, there is no funds coming to make a project, because they basically always find donors, which is government usually, to fund projects, right? So to them, it doesn't make sense to actually explore the possibilities, because they're not going to attract any money for this anyway.
So your work is essentially, yeah, is funded by public institutions.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what's weird, happening. Right? I mean, I went to Norway. I couldn't afford it, right? I mean, I joined the Bitcoin space extremely late, so I could not afford. There is this, it's also funny, there is this perception that everybody who is a Bitcoin developer, it has to be Bitcoin whale. But because, I mean, you're a developer, you understand the protocol, yes, but maybe you're a developer and maybe it's easy for you to understand the protocol in 2018.
Hilarious.
I mean, that can happen, right?
This is really strange, really strange. I don't want to take too much time of yours, but just for closing, sure. Again, let's go back a little bit to the lightning. Is there anything like users, what if, just as, you know, naive question, would it make a change, would it make a difference if more and more people run their own nodes? Would that somehow, it's a really maybe a stupid question, but what could users or the average person out there contribute to, you know, to the process or maturation of the Lightning Network? You know, because you talked about, you know, this and that, you know, all these problems. Is there anything we can do as a, you know, as a user?
Sure. So the first thing is you can wait. It's like literally just waiting, right? I mean, I know there's this 18-month meme. I recently put out a tweet where I said, hey, I'm running my Lightning node for 18 months and it worked perfectly fine, right? So kind of like reversing this meme. But in general, as I mentioned, technology needs some time to grow mature. So in that sense, waiting is actually a very good strategy. Mm-hmm. If you don't want to wait, you can actually download a node, you can install a node, you can download a wallet. And if you use it and it doesn't work, file a bug report. Right? I mean, mm-hmm. open source development thrives heavily by feedback. And I know many people who are like, I'm just too dumb, or maybe this was already like known and obvious, or like I know many people who are very like insecure, and there is a certain like invisible barrier for them to like go to GitHub, to these like geeky platforms, and basically just like open an issue and say, hey, this is me, this is what I'm trying to do, and this is not working. Why? Right? Yeah. And also developers are very rough in their feedback sometimes, like, where's your log file? We didn't put your log file. What am I supposed to say?
What is a log file? What is a command line?
Yeah, exactly, exactly.
Because this is the first thing that people, you know, would need to learn. I mean, what, you know, just typing
But this is what some people could do. They could say, hey, I'm not a developer. I'm an end user. I try to use it. To the best of my case, this is my bug report. Right? And then I think a reasonable developer would actually be also a little bit more comforting in being like, hey, you need this. And then you'd be like, yeah, but I don't know how to do that. Right? And of course, I mean, maybe your bug report is like the developer is not supposed to educate the user then. Right, because if the developer would do that all the time, the developer would not come to developing anymore. But I think there is an opportunity to have a conversation, right? And I think users can be brave and initiate this conversation.
Okay. I know it's, I mean, I can put myself into the shoes, you know, of the end user. It's, yeah, you know, I mean, of course, it makes a difference if you have a smooth, easy, you know, user-friendly plug-and-play device. You know, you don't have to learn command lines and, you know, and then update something. Maybe, you know, something doesn't work and then you have to, you know, I'm not sure whether people have the, yeah, time. Yeah, you take the time, but then having, you know, this immediate communication line with someone, you know, like, getting instructed, mentored, coached, or whatever by someone. I'm not sure what it looks like in reality for the end user, to be honest with you. I mean, that's why I'm such a huge advocate.
But that's the point. There's like different levels, right? So, I mean, one is the technology. And I mean, I wouldn't ask an end user who is completely not tech savvy to download a Lightning node and do it, right? I mean, it kind of doesn't make sense to them. Right, because it's a complex software setup and process, and it's like, why, right? And what people can't seem to forget is that, like, even if you have like your awesome cell phone and everything is like really drag and drop and nice and whatever, by the end of the day, it's command line tools in the back who power all of this, right? And there is some people who actually need to run those tools and to be able to maintain them. So currently, when you build a technology, you start doing that because this is how computer scientists work with each other. They don't have time to build like good user experience, fancy processes, stuff like that. And there's this intermediate time frame where people actually start doing good user experience. And there's this gap that is there initially, and it has to be filled. But again, I mean, that's the waiting part.
Well, René, I really, really enjoyed our talk because you bring in, you know, really fascinating new perspectives and you know, new insights into this whole space. Why don't you tell my listeners, followers, and viewers, where can they find you? Where do you want to direct them? What should they, you know, educate themselves on? Anything?
So, I mean, you can find my YouTube channel, obviously, where I have a lot of videos where I try to explain basics of Lightning and Bitcoin. It's not only oriented to developers, but also to laymen. It's a little bit geeky, though, to say. I kind of like, I am a nerd, so I'm embracing this there. I can live my nerd dream. I mean, I'm writing Mastering the Lightning Network. You can go to the GitHub repository, github.com/lnbook/lnbook, LN for Lightning Network. Obviously, I'm on Twitter. You can ping me a message there. My direct messages are open usually. I mean, if you like to support my work in general, I have a Patreon page and a fundraiser. You can support this, which would be highly appreciated, obviously, but only if you can afford to do this, actually.
Right. And your website, René-Picard.de. I'm going to put those in the show notes too, just in case, right?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, the website exists, yes. It's very outdated, as we discussed. I haven't cared so much about it recent times. Yes, but I wanted to say one more thing, and now I forgot it. But I guess that's okay.
Is there anything like
I mean, that's the important thing. Many people tend to ask questions on Twitter or on Telegram or in private. Just go to bitcoin.stackexchange.com and ask a question there, because it's going to be indexed very well by search engines. There are experts there answering them. They're very happy to answer them, right? I would argue if you want to get like free consulting from me, don't send an email to me. Just ask the question in Stack Exchange. I'm following the questions there. It's a very high chance I'm going to answer it. Right? And, I mean, yeah, I mean, you can pay for consulting because you want to have it in private, then you can contact me. But if you want to have something free, I usually direct you to bitcoin.stackexchange anyway, because then others can also participate from the knowledge.
Exactly. Others can also learn. Yeah. And then you don't have to repeat yourself, you know, constantly.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And so, I mean, use Telegram, use Twitter, but just point to the question, right, if it's not being answered yet. But I mean, chances are very high that the experts are already there answering questions.
Mm-hmm.
And to actually emphasize on this, most of the protocol improvements that I have directly worked on were actually direct consequences from people asking questions on bitcoin.stackexchange. Like, I even found a vulnerability in Lightning once where somebody was asking a question on bitcoin.stackexchange. It's like, wow, if that happens, that has severe consequences. I was like looking up the words, I was like, oh my God, somebody can do this. We should fix this, right? It was not a bad one, right? But I mean, come on, right? I mean,
yeah.
So this is a really important process, asking questions, right? And this goes back to the end users again, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the website is a little bit more technical, but you can ask like layman questions. That's okay.
Mm. No, but it's really beautiful, the open source community, open source space, you know, where I think the whole point, right, is to make it more transparent, make it more, you know, mature and learning from one another and, right, and developing new things, right?
Sure.
Right. So, Rene, I really enjoyed our talk. I'll see you sometime soon again in person. I'm not sure whether you ever come to Vienna, or maybe we'll see each other at some conference. Would be awesome.
I try not to fly so much.
Okay, gotcha. Especially because of the virus thing, maybe coronavirus. I'm a little bit concerned too, but that's another topic.
Well, actually, for environmental reasons, and I think it's important to mention.
Okay,
on the podcast.
Fair enough. Yeah, totally. But how then could you travel? You know, I mean, we don't have a spaceship yet, so how would you prefer?
When I went from Germany to Norway, I took the train for 30 hours, and I very desperately said, if Greta Thunberg can do it, I can do it.
Yeah, and you have a lot of time, right, to do your work, read, or whatever.
It was a very beautiful train ride. I only had to change trains 9 times. It was not so
Oh my
long.
God. As long as you don't, you know, miss a train or something. No, it can be a pretty nice experience. I think I love train too, you know, because it's really
train is nice. It's much nicer than plane, actually. You can walk around. I mean, obviously,
yeah.
30 hours on a train in comparison to 2 hours on a plane, and maybe the plane is more convenient still. But I try not to fly. It's really, really necessary.
Awesome. René, thank you so much for your time again. I really enjoyed our talk. Hope to see you soon. And yeah, good luck with all your work.
Thanks for your work. And thanks for your work for the community of trying to educate people and spread the message.
Yeah, we got to do this. You know, we got to somehow accelerate this whole process. And, you know, we cannot enforce it, but at least give people some kind of empowerment, inspirations and knowledge, you know.
I agree.
All right.
Hey.
Have a good evening. Bye-bye. So, what you make of this fascinating interview with talk with René Picard, the original from Germany and lives in Norway. And I wish we could have a little bit more time, but maybe it would have been too overwhelming, too much. I didn't want to go into technical details. I wanted to have, you know, René's vision, background, what's his perspectives, what are the real challenges, the obstacles, how can we, you know, each and every one of us individuals also maybe contribute somehow, not only by educating ourselves and adopting Bitcoin and maybe running a full node eventually, hopefully, whether, you know, with command lines or with a, you know, preferably, I would say, with a plug and play, smooth, user-friendly, full node device. But, you know, it all comes, boils down to, you know, self-empowerment, self-responsibility, education, knowledge, comprehension, And you know, this evolutionary process is just interaction. That's why, you know, the total connector, I'm really doing my best, whatever it takes to connect the dots for myself, for you, for all my listeners, my followers, my subscribers. So thank you again so much for following me, for listening to me, for supporting me so far. If you want to help me in any shape or form, please give me a positive review on Apple, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, or any other podcast platform on YouTube. Give me a like, follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is Keyvan Devani. And I'm also going to put, of course, Renee's you know, contact and information sources in the show notes. But I really appreciate that you know, are really supporting and listening to my podcast. And please, if you're an ethical sponsor, ethical Bitcoin sponsors, get in touch with me because I want to deliver more highest quality content, you know, face-to-face, personal interviews, flying, driving, whatever, going by train somewhere, and doing these things, doing these interviews, these podcasts and YouTube interviews, video interviews in highest quality and with, you know, with the best experts, Bitcoiners, developers, coders, product developers, visionaries, scientists, technologists, and what have you. All right, that's about it. The Total Connector says bye and have a great day. Thank you so much for listening to the Total Bitcoin Podcast Show.